Next item on our agenda is the Kelp Anchor Project. We're going to have a presentation from, I think, Mr. Keil.
And Greg.
And Greg, too.
Good morning. So first of all, on behalf of myself and Greg, Mike, friends of Goleta Beach, the Beacon Board, I'd like to thank them for giving us the opportunity to look into this endeavor. There's a lot of debate, there's a lot of discussion, there's a lot of scientific investigation on this matter, and it just continues. There's so many variables, there's so many unknowns, when something changes, it's a ripple effect, domino effect down the line, whether it's biological, oceanographic, oceanic processes, it never ends. And what we're trying to do is to see if there is a way to using artificial structures to aid in the reestablishment of these beds. They're extremely unique in that they grew on sand bottom. This is a unique phenomenon to the Santa Barbara that is paramount for people to understand. Kelp grows on hard structure. The holdfast is not a root. It is a system that grabs on to hard structure and holds a plant to get to the surface. And this whole system of these sand-dwelling beds, where they grew on worm tubes, and they basically persisted, at least as far as we know, they were there since prior to Europeans colonizing the area. And we watched them start their disappearance, beginning with the 1982-83 El Nino, and then subsequent El Ninos, storm activities, took whatever was remaining, and they're gone. They have not reestablished. We have spent a good part of my life working on this project, whether it was as a kid and I didn't even know it, or as more recently, starting in the early 2000s. It's very puzzling as to why these things aren't coming back when kelp is generally healthy within the region of the Santa Barbara Channel. You go on rock structures, kelp is healthy. The sewer pipeline running right through Goleta Bay, it's healthy. The reef between Goleta Point and Colloyal Point, healthy, seems to be doing its job. I started looking at this because I grew up in the area, I was familiar with this, I've watched all the efforts with sand and sand accretion and nourishment and all of this stuff. I believe that resistance that kelp bed offered played a role. And all that though becomes moot if we can't aid in its recovery. So the focus of our endeavor here is to try to see if we can put a system in that meets a litany of criteria, biologically and physically, to see if this is possible. So this website that Greg put together, because there's so much information on this and we have to focus on that report right there today, Greg and I grew up as friends since first grade or so. We've been buds ever since. I went off to Seattle and I've been the chief engineer for the Seattle Aquarium for I'm in my 33rd year, can't believe that. 2018 started out, the first survey we did in 2018 was actually from a satellite in space, which I think is kind of cool. We have these instruments that we can use. That is the center of our site, and those fronds on the surface are stuff that is growing on our structures. And just keep in mind that fronds on the surface in this location in Goleta Bay have not existed for 35 plus years. So we're doing something that's working. This is really, truly an endeavor that it takes a lot of caution as we move through it. if you're out there when the water's calm, the winds haven't been blowing, these fronds are going to come to the surface and you'll see them. Lobster fishermen see them. We have found more lobster buoys around our site, and we suspect that some of our large plants that have grown all the way to the surface, and we come back and they're gone, that they possibly got snagged on lobster traps as they're pulling their gear. So there's really no other rational explanation. The plants didn't just die. And as you can see here, there's a line right there. Now you pull on that trap and away they go. Just so you all know in this room, this isn't just two guys that think we have an idea and we're going to try it. This is a big deal, and we're going to try to get this. If this is possible to do, and I want this to be very clear, I believe we will figure it out, and we will determine that. We may also determine that it's not possible to do, and that's worth noting. Again, working in this marine environment and trying to do something like this is extremely difficult. Lots of things going on. What we're showing here is grazing. And these guys, kelp crabs, they're called kelp crabs because that is their primary source of food. When the kelp is gone, they will become carnivorous. But if you look on that fronds in the background on one of our plants, you can see how that's been nibbled away. So as we started doing this, we started noticing that we would get a percentage of plants to start to grow and they'd make it to the surface, but it wasn't as high as I'd like it. We'd see these young plants and then they would succumb to this grazing by primarily kelp crabs, but there's a number of snail species as well. So getting back to the ecosystems and the balance of these ecosystems and the history, some of you probably heard the term diminishing baselines. As time progresses, people forget, they lose this perspective. Those large plants on the right, when we start looking at those and we're digging through them and I'm trying to move fronds away for Greg to get pictures of holdfasts and stuff like that, I'm willing to say without exception, there's an octopus living in there. And out there on the sand barrens, yes, Greg's pointing out evidence right there. Out on the sand barrens, there's nothing out there. There's no refuge. It's for these animals to live. And when they find something like this, whether they come in as larvae or whatever, they'll hang out. And they seem to actually mitigate and control some of these grazing pressures by these crabs and snails. This is documented evidence. These large beds can attenuate and deflect these currents. Also, that kelp that's between the pier and that you see on the side of the pier from time to time right now, we lifted those up and they're all growing on the cobble that was used in those textile, geotextile bags that broke apart. So the kelp is growing on those, and those kelp plants will march the rocks out to sea and then they'll come back. But anyway, that's what's going on there. In a test site where we're dealing with just a small number of plants, what if we, instead of having a single column, a structure for something to grow on, what if we put a couple close together, like, you know, 18 inches apart or whatever, 2, 3, or 4. So this is our cluster column site, just a test. And I want to say, when we were putting that site in, this was in the middle of our grid, which sits in the middle of the historical kelp bed in Goleta Bay. And we had a number of large plants right next to them where we were putting this in. And I've never seen this before, but there was worm tubes everywhere with juvenile kelp plants growing on them. We speculate that those plants were there because of the spores produced by the larger plants that we grew, and that was the next generation. And this is the process that these beds need to survive, and that is a kelp plant on the left growing on a diapetra worm tube. And those haptera crawl across the seafloor seeking something to hang on to, but there's nothing there. Meanwhile, Diopetra is seeking refuge amongst those holdfast. So it's a symbiotic relationship. It's a win-win. Those Diopetra ultimately become the tendrils in mass number that anchored these big holdfast to the seafloor. So we went around, you can see the rubber bands on the columns that we put in. And by the way, we tapered the ends because sediment sitting on the top took away that spot for spores to settle on. So we said, let's taper the top. These little modifications. Well, so to speed things up, because it takes 6 to 9 months to get there, I said, let's pluck some of these off and stick them on our columns. We know we get natural recruitment. We know we get growth. When we dive on the rocky reefs, we don't see the concentrations of these animals. Something else is going on there. And I know as a diver, and my experience is that octopus, a lot of them, these two spots, they live on these reefs, in the structures on these reefs. They're not on the sand barrens. However, if we can get a large kelp plant, they do live there. But how do you get there before it gets grazed? So we decided to take the columns, which are 30 inches long. This is just a part of one. And I said, let's put a chamber on the top for an octopus to reside in. We did that in November. You can see them on the boat there. And we put those in the middle of November. I went back again, go ahead, Greg, the end of December. There's our cluster column site I showed you, and there's the octo column site. 22 of the 25 columns that are in that site have octopus living in them at the end of December. The two spot, you can see them right there. And that Kellett's whelk pulled into the chamber on the left was sitting, and we saw this on several different shells. It was sitting right at the base of that opening, and I picked it up the day before. It's empty. I put it back down. The next day it was pulled into the chamber. They used the shells, the empty shells, to close the door. They're amazing animals. In the winter months, you have very high nitrogen content in the water. This is when the kelp goes crazy. It just starts to grow. That's the nutrient that it's relying on, not the sunlight. Those fronds get to the surface, then they, through photosynthesis, they produce the sugars that are translocated back down to that holdfast to grow it bigger and prepare the next generation of fronds to get to the surface. This is a very complicated thing, but these are just pictures of Stoss Williams there on the left. He dove it Sunday. We had a dive out there where it was pretty clear we were diving the grid. 3 days late, now that was a week of no wind. 3 days of consecutive afternoon breezes. We dove the same site 3 days later, and I'm looking down and I'm going, that looks dark down there. That's weird. Again, it was fairly clear at the surface. We go down, and when I hit about 10 feet off the bottom, as we went down, talk about eerie. It was completely black. I mean, you couldn't see your hand if it was touching your mask. It's not just storms. Look, the beach has been at its narrowest state on some of my trips down here at the end of summer and fall, when you would expect the beach to be the widest, and it's been wider in March and April when you would expect it to be the narrowest. It all depends on how much wind, how much storm activity you have. Look, this is gonna be an interesting year. I want to look at what those cluster columns do. We have large kelp plants growing on them. They're going to seed surrounding worm tubes. If what we saw with those other plants is repeated, then that holds true. That you put a large kelp plant out there, certain spacing, it will seed the worm tubes naturally, which is what we're trying to do. If the octo columns do what we think they're going to do, any plants trying to grow on those structures are going to have a much better chance, because the grazing invertebrates are going to be controlled from the get-go. Now, if we wanted to restore a 1.25 by 1/4 mile wide bed in Goleta Bay, and we put one of these on 50-foot centers, just picture that, and you had a large kelp plant, it was doing its seeding, you're talking about 3,500 of those. That's not a little undertaking, but it's doable.
really incredible, the passion that you bring to this project and the time that you've put into this scientific experiment over a number of years, and the progress that you're making. You've come back a couple times with progress reports to us, and it's really impressive to see what you've learned and how you've adapted. And are you trademarking the octocolumn?
Everybody asks me that.
But there's a lot of potential here, and we're all learning from it, and we really appreciate it. Wouldn't have been happened without your taking the initiative to do this and bringing your scientific expertise and your time and your passion and your family's commitment to this and your financial investment in this. And, you know, I do think it is getting close to where we need to begin to think about financially assisting in this. You've made progress. You've demonstrated it, you know, on a shoestring. And we're here to try and learn the next phase of how this can be replicated in a significant way and have a benefit that we can demonstrate and shop to other state and federal grant funding sources as a way to replicate this and have amplify it and magnify the benefit. Director Richards and Director Gama.
I also want to say thank you for this update, for your report, for your work on this project. I'm grateful to see the progress that you're making. One question that I had is, what kind of collaboration do you have with UCSB? I know you mentioned meeting with some people there. Are they involved in any of this as a research project?
No. What we've been told is, without funding, they're tapped.
And I just want to say, too, I support the Beacon's continued financial support or whatever support we can give to have this project continue.
Thank you. Director Collin?
Thank you. It was really interesting, and I think the that last photo of that octopus should become your mascot.
Yeah. Now that is called the Two Spot, and it's Octopus by Maculoides. Look them up. They're amazing. Read a little bit about octopus. They are got to be one of the most fascinating animals on the planet.
And the second question is, I remember back in 1982, there was a lot of harvesting of the sea kelp. And I want to know if that led to some of our problems, because I recall being on the beach and being swallowed up by loose kelp and the root balls floating to the beach.
So Kelco, those of you that remember, harvested a lot of kelp along the southern coast of California. These beds were massive. And they produce, the end product was primarily alginate, and it's used in, there's none of you in this room that haven't used something that has alginate in it today or yesterday, let's just put it that way, whether it's a pharmaceutical, an industrial product, a food, whatever, fertilizers, you name it. So when these beds disappeared, they tried to hold on to kelp plants by stapling them to the seafloor and everything else, but they lost the battle. And again, these beds survive by their sheer critical mass, their density, their structure. Once you thin them out, individual plants, they can't withstand those oceanic conditions. They no longer change the localized conditions to favor their continued growth and propagation. Again, in those reports, one of those, the Goleta Beach erosion one, talks about all the benefits for restoring these kelp beds. This goes way beyond the beach, though. We're focused on that.
Just 2 seconds. I know we're running out of time, but I know you're very, very passionate about this, and the funding comes from your own personal funding. That's what you're doing now.
Visa credit card.
It's really, really great, and this is fascinating what you're doing. And thank you so much for what you're doing.
I did want to say that initially Beacon put we had allocated, I think, $15,000. I think it went beyond that over time, basically for the permitting and staff time to go in and get the permits for this. And I do want to say that I will stay engaged with Bob and his team, but also we're looking at a great habitat opportunities, and anything we can do to reduce energy of the ocean offshore within the nearshore environment certainly helps, I think, keep the sand there. As we said, getting sand to the beach, and then how do we keep it there longer? This might be one of the ways to do it. So I'll stay engaged with the team and bring something back to this in May.
Thank you again, Mr. Keil and Mr. Christman.